Now, here's a bit of a different one. This isn't a system review per se, it's a platform or even an architecture review, because MSX wasn't one particular system made by one particular company. It was a specification for systems to adhere to, first announced by Microsoft in June 1983, and was an attempt to standardise the swathes of individual platforms currently on the market into one single compatible architecture, much like the IBM PC Compatible would do in the years following. On this occasion, the stroke of genius didn't come from Bill Gates, it was the work of Natsuhiko Nishi, who was Vice President of Microsoft Japan and also Director of ASCII Corporation, ASCII being another standardising format. Because of this, the MSX machine saw little release in the States, but were hugely popular in Japan and other Eastern markets, where the IBM PC Compatibles and lower-end machines such as the Commodore 64 hadn't already started to consume the market. The MSX platform came before the release of Nintendo's Famicom, known as the NES in the West, and therefore quickly became the gaming platform of choice, with developers such as Konami and Hudson Soft quick to jump on board. As for the MSX name, it's a little unclear. Most people agree that it stands for Microsoft Extended, in line with the built-in BASIC interpreter. However, according to Nishi, MSX could stand for Machines with Software Exchangeability, although he also reportedly stated that it was named after the MX missile. Nothing like ambiguity, hey Nishi? So, let's take a look at Japan in the early 80s and see why and how the MSX format was created. Whilst in the West we had IBM PC Compatibles, the Spectrum, the Commodore 64 and some other well-known brands, the landscape was a little different in the East. The main systems in use were the NEC PC series, Fujitsu's FM series and Hitachi's Basic Master. Now, these machines were used for business and gaming alike, but shared little compatibility with Western systems, although each system did feature a variant of Microsoft's BASIC interpreter in ROM, in a similar fashion to our beloved Western machines. The problem was that the variations of this BASIC were incompatible, and other manufacturers such as Panasonic, Casio and Pioneer wanted a slice of the computing market. Inspired by the standardisation of VHS tapes, Nishi stepped up and proposed the MSX system, and Japanese manufacturers quickly saw the advantage of this, especially as they would still have the scope to add their own quirks to individual machines. Now, the standard was based on the Spectravideo SV328 computer, mainly because it was built with many off-the-shelf parts, with the specifications fairly similar to Western machines at the time. Many producers stepped up to produce the first MSX machines, such as Canon, Fujitsu, Hitachi, Toshiba, Pioneer, Yamaha, and probably any other Japanese sounding companies you can think of, none of them wanting to miss out on the opportunity to have a piece of hardware at launch. Now, this struck fear into Western companies, with the Japanese being renowned for crushing Western dominance with their technology. However, as the Spectrum had gained so much ground in the UK, and likewise the Commodore 64 in the States, this fear was unfounded. Although MSX never became the worldwide standard its visionaries had hoped for, mainly because of its lateness to the Western markets, this didn't stop companies like Commodore from introducing the ill-advised and somewhat unnecessary Plus 4 range, which was designed in part to compete better with the MSX hardware and to appeal to its user base. If the MSX system had arrived earlier, it would have undoubtedly been a force to reckon with, just like it became in the Eastern markets, where it quickly became the main computer system throughout the 1980s, until more powerful machines popped up and the IBM PC Compatibles became cheap enough to stamp on its ground.
MSX will reduce the amount of writing.
The MSX platform suffered a number of issues, despite their universal architecture. The first was a disadvantage with the way their video memory was accessed. As the hardware differed from machine to machine, a convoluted method accounting for different video hardware was employed. Bespoke Western machines accessed video memory directly, and therefore had a potentially large speed advantage. This led to noticeable slowdown on several ZX Spectrum ports.
And the Spectrum, by the way, is two or three times as powerful as the MSX machines.
The popular Toshiba HX10 was unable to read certain key combinations, so the perfect key layout of QA, OP and space, and don't tell me there's a better one, could not be used. which was a problem in games without definable keys. This led to later ports simply using the arrow keys or the MSX joystick standard. Another issue, this time with the architecture specification, was that manufacturers weren't told where the cartridge and RAM banks should be stored. This required software producers to search for this information on the fly so that programs would function. These machines were complicated and led to further slowdown. Additionally, some software didn't bother to look at all, and so crashed out on certain machines. Now, the hardware these systems were based around features: a Zilog Z80 CPU running at 3.58 MHz, 32 kilobytes of ROM with 16 kilobytes taken up by MSX Basic, 8 kilobytes minimum RAM with machines providing up to 128K, much like other systems, a Texas Instruments TMS9918 graphics chip with 16 kilobytes of VRAM, featuring a resolution of 256 by 192 with 16 colours and 32 one-colour sprites. A General Instruments AY38910 sound chip was included and an Intel 8255 interface controller. In many ways, this setup was similar to the Sega SG-1000 and ColecoVision hardware and was somewhat underpowered when compared to the Commodore 64, for example. To reduce cost, a number of MSX machines went down the route of glue logic, which integrated several chips into one component. And most systems also featured a proper tactile keyboard, rather than some rubber chiclet job. A good selling point for the systems, but this contributed to higher prices. A number of well-known franchises actually established themselves on the MSX hardware. These include Bomberman, Eggerland, and Parodius. These were sold alongside a plethora of ports from other systems. Here are some of my favourites. Machines varied in price, but were typically around the £200 and up mark, being slashed to around the £99 mark from 1985 onwards. There were over 50 MSX variants by a number of different producers, all featuring their own looks, ports, quirks, and memory sizes. This Casio is one of my particular favourites, resembling a cross between a preschool toy and a computer. There are also machines like this Hotbit, which was sold exclusively in Brazil. One of the most popular, especially in the West, was the Toshiba HX10, one of which I picked up for less than £50 from a Facebook selling group. But I also have a rare Pioneer model which sits at the other end of quirkiness to the Toshiba. Let's take a look. Okay, so I have two MSX machines in my possession. The first is this Toshiba HX10 with 64K of RAM. Now this is pretty standard and pretty common, especially over in the West. Takes cartridge, takes tape, all the normal sort of stuff. This beast, which looks like some sort of hi-fi component or a video player, is a Pioneer PX7. It had the capabilities to connect with video disc players and use editing abilities such as Genlock to overlay text and titles. It takes the normal cartridges, it's got the normal connectors for joysticks, it's got a volume control, keyboard control. On the back it has the audio in and out, video in and out, RF, we've got system controls for the video disc player, normal data recorder, normal RGB out, and printer port. It's quite a hefty beast. The PX7 also sold with a video art tablet and a video art package which allowed you to use it as a drawing tablet. Quite innovative at the time. The MSX ran from 1983 to 1985 before receiving an update in the form of the MSX2 standard. This was followed by the MSX 2 Plus in 1988 and the 16-bit MSX Turbo R range in 1990, all of which warrant their own subsequent video. So please subscribe to be sure to catch it. As with all 8-bit systems, the original MSX hardware ran its course and slowly faded away into history. But in doing so, it firmly made its mark and helped to carry the standardization flag all the way up to our present day.
Hours of entertainment, quite literally.
Thank you for watching my MSX architecture review. Please subscribe if you haven't already done so. Feel free to click a video below. And if you fancy supporting me on Patreon, please click the link below. It is very much appreciated. But thank you for watching in any case, and good night.